Today we're talking about film festival.
That adds color to the story.
Welcome to Butter City. This is our third season, and we got a great lineup this year. We're talking all about film and all about Minnesota. We're kicking off our first show with Craig Laurence Rice. He's an award-winning director, producer, been up for four Emmy Awards, nominated for an award with the NAACP, and I'd like to welcome Craig to the studio today.
Hi.
How you doing?
Good. I'm doing good.
Thanks for joining us.
Yeah. I'm glad to be here. Yeah.
So let's just, you know, for folks who might not be familiar yet with your work, how'd you get into filmmaking? I know you started out in school. Did you start at MCAT or did you start out in Southern California?
I started out in film specifically. I had been a musician for a long time before that, but I had always, ever since I was 5 years old, wanted to make films, and I just didn't know how to do that. I grew up here in the Twin Cities, and so it's like wanting to make films was like wanting to be an astronaut, and I didn't know how to do it, so kind of drifted into the music business for a long, long time. And I met a woman who I was dating who suggested I go to film school, and I didn't have a clue you could actually take it up in school, so I started at the University of Minnesota, then went to what's now is MCTC, and then I went to Minneapolis College of Art and Design, and then went to the University of Southern California, USC Film School, and that's where I graduated from.
So, I mean, that's a lot of schools. Mm-hmm. To pursue filmmaking. I mean, what was there always sort of one more thing that you wanted to?
Yeah, I had always kind of been interested in films. I was lucky. My family, my parents were really into the arts, and so I always knew about arts. I mean, we went to the symphony on Sundays as a kid. We listened to jazz and rock around the house, or R&B. Everybody can draw in my family. Everybody plays an instrument in my family. So we watched films as a kid by the director, so I always knew what a director was, again. And so I started reading books about filmmaking when I was young, and I read a book, Lessons with Eisenstein, which is a Russian filmmaker, and in one of his books he had a course study that the ideal school that he would create, what a filmmaker really needed to learn. Mm-hmm. And I went to college based on the classes that he had listed in there. So if it was sociology, anthropology, literature, history, that's how I went to school. So I went to the schools where I could learn the best in those areas. And so then kind of worked through it that way. So theater and acting, and I studied all that stuff. I studied that at the U. And
So I mean, there had to be something in his work that really spoke to you to be, I mean, that's a lot of dedication.
I think he's brilliant. I mean, I think that because he sort of defined filmmaking, and I always believe filmmaking was for people, was an important medium of expression. I believe that film has to have a certain passion and personality, and not just to make a bunch of pretty pictures and to, you know, just to make a lot of money. I always thought there needed to be a message inside of it. I mean, all film is propaganda, as you know, and so I really felt that a filmmaker needed to be responsible as a person for to others and the planet and all those things. And so I wanted to be the best that I could be. And but it's like being a musician. You study with the best you study. So my first discipline was music. So as a filmmaker, I think as a filmmaker, you need to study with the best, and you need to, you know, sort of take that approach. So that's what I did. So
nice.
You know.
I mean, I know that after you were in the film world for a while, you ended up making, you know, the film Half Past Autumn, mm-hmm, mm-hmm, about Gordon Parks. Mm-hmm. And, you know, listening to you, you can hear the relationship to your, you know, how you think about filmmaking and kind of why this project would be a really great fit for you.
Well, I think it comes from my mother. I mean, point blank, my mother used to say, you know, you should, I always knew about Gordon Parks. It wasn't a time that I didn't know about Paul Robeson, Gordon Parks, or Duke Ellington. And I mean, not a moment in my life I didn't know those three names. And so my parents really kind of pushed that responsibility as an African-American artist on you. And Gordon was obviously one of the main ones. My mother gave me his book for, I can't remember what birthday I was, for Choice of Weapons. So I was always kind of aware of him. So he never thinking that I'd ever make a film with him, but I always kind of he implanted certain value systems in me. So I think that as I went through life, it was kind of that this is what Duke Ellington would do, this is what Gordon would do, this is what Paul Robeson would do as an artist. So as a musician, I was Duke Ellington, you know. So I kind of process it that way. And while I was at school at USC, I had an opportunity to go to New York and meet Gordon. And at that time, this would have been 79, 80, I told him I wanted to make a film with him. So it wasn't until, 1998, did I get a chance to actually make that thing happen. So,
okay, so just for folks who are tuning in and may not know who Gordon Parks is, let's take a look at this clip.
Okay, sure.
And then keep this conversation going.
Thanks.
For the past 2 years, a retrospective of Gordon Parks' photography has set attendance records at museums across the country.
When I was a kid, there weren't a lot of people of color who were doing things in the media. Gordon was one of the few, and he was a man documenting black life in a major magazine, and so I was just drawn to his pictures early on.
The most important thing that Gordon has accomplished is universality, his ability to transcend language and race, to have been able to touch so many people.
Gordon Parks has certainly been one of the most successful photographers during his time, and he, in choosing the camera to use as a weapon, he certainly rose to the top of his profession.
I think it's hard to classify Gordon's progress as an artist because he is so multi-talented. He's been photographing, he's also been composing music, he's been writing.
When we began organizing the exhibition Half Past Autumn, I had many, many conversations with Gordon about what it was we could do that would encompass the broadness of his vision. We decided to develop the exhibition as a kind of narrative that would guide visitors through the story of his life.
So that's a project that looks at kind of the breadth of Gordon Parks' work. I think it's a beautiful project, and I think folks should really take a chance to check it out if they haven't seen it. What was that like to actually be in a situation where you're like, you're with him, you're able to really, say something about his work, too?
Yeah. It was a huge, huge responsibility. I mean, he entrusted me with his legacy. I mean, at the time when we did this, he was 89 years old, so it wasn't like he was going to live forever. So it was like, this may be the last thing that he does and people will start to define. So it was a real responsibility. But what I had to not do as a filmmaker was, even though personally I love Gordon, I had to not genuflect to him. Because as a documentary filmmaker, as you know, you have to push and you have to, go for it and sometimes make them not comfortable. And the ending of this film, we really kind of deal with his, the end of his life, and we talk about it in the film. And that was very difficult for him. And he didn't want to do it. And I had to insist that, none of us are getting out of here alive, Gordon. So, it's going to be a time that's coming where you have to, reflect on it, and that's really kind of, from the moment you're born, you're actually preparing yourself to die. And that was very tough, but you have to do that as a filmmaker, because that's ultimately our job, is to really begin to impart this information, so.
Was this in your career, you had already been in the business for a while, and then you get in a situation where you're making this film about, your mentor, and, we talked about that from a distance, but was this a chance for you to also, when you have to sort of test, bring your skills, you're a documentary filmmaker, so it's somebody you really respect, but you got to bring bring your confidence about what you know about your craft and your tools.
Yeah. Well, he's a director, so, and he's the first director, so, or African-American director, so you know, you got him looking at you like this the whole time. It's like, you sure you want this? I mean, there was a great story, and I'll tell you the story very quickly. We were shooting in Brazil, and I had this vision in my mind where I wanted to shoot him in Brazil. So we were driving up and down the coast of Brazil. Like 10 minutes in, Gordon says, this is a good place. And I said, no. So we drive for another half hour up and down the coast, and we come back to the place he picked. And I had to literally get on my knees and say, you are the master. you know better than me. You know, he's just that good. You know, he's been doing it a long time. In my background, you know, documentary was something that I did, but I've done commercials, and I was a music video director for a long time, and I started in feature films. And so I kind of tried to bring all that visual narrative and all that word narrative and story narrative to this piece, so it's not a traditional documentary. It's really is kind of a story of a man, and it has a middle, beginning, and end, and not necessarily in that order. Mm-hmm. And so I kind of tried to make it as a creative a process as I could, with the respect of somebody who was a master in all of his crafts. Mm-hmm. So it was a challenge for me, but I liked that. I think for me, it's what I love about filmmaking. I approach film as an art form, mm-hmm. you know, primarily. I don't come from a journalism background, which a lot of documentary people come from. So I took it from, I want to create a piece of art that represents this man, and what's the best way to do that.
So. Let's take a look at one more clip mm-hmm. from mm-hmm. the movie, and then come back around.
Perfect. The prairie is still in me, in my talk, and in my manners. I go back there now and then to gaze into the rivers I envied for flowing off to places I thought I would never see. Our old clapboard house, surviving storms and tornadoes, still leans into the oak tree shade where I used to dream in the huge silence. I still have a passion for living, so this is no farewell, but a gathering of moments that I hope will make the trials of others much easier to bear.
Wow, Craig, I mean, it's like, what a chance too, I mean, to be able to make that film at that stage in your career. And I know you started to touch on this too a little bit earlier, but you know, you work across the field. I mean, you know, it's not just directing and producing, which I think a lot of people actually bounce between those two roles, but you've worked with clients in commercials, mm-hmm. music videos, mm-hmm. And documentary work. And that's got to leave you with, or does it leave you with a perspective that shapes the way you can tell a story?
I think yes. I think stories are really how we learn about people, and just in general. And you know, being black in America, you come from a real strong story standpoint anyways. I mean, I didn't know my grandfathers, either one of them, but I mean, the things were passed down, and so stories is really huge for me. And I think that as an artist, I try to say that. And I think even in music, because again, I said my first background is sort of started in music, and even this piece that we just saw, that it's the whole ending started with the music. I had wanted to do something with this piece of music, and I felt like the end of life for me. Mm-hmm. And so it was kind of, that was the story that fit into the story. But yeah, I've tried to make films. I have made films. I started a film with Desmond Tutu several years ago that, unfortunately, called The Rainbow Warrior, that we shot a couple of days and never, he didn't want to finish it because he was, I'm not sure why, he used, it was right before 9/11 we shot it, and he decided that he didn't want to be so visible, and that's not even an American story, that's just sort of a black story, but about an African who really believed in forgiveness as the ultimate way of healing. Mm-hmm. That was a story that I wanted to tell, but I tried it on, you know, white people. I started a film with Michael Graves, who was an architect designer. I just think it's just people. I find people fascinating. I really do. I just find them just fascinating. I'm one of those kids that drive, you know, as I travel out with my dad and his family and drive down the highway and all these people in all these towns with all these lights on. I want to know who they are, what they do, and how they live their life. Where do they go? What, you know, I find that just fascinating.
Well, and I think that's what's attractive about documentary is that mm-hmm. You can't write the characters that you find.
Yeah. Yeah,
because they're just not going to be as believable.
Yeah, yeah, it's just fascinating to me. Just fascinating. So that's kind of what I take it is. That to me is filmmaking, and I don't care if it's even in music videos. I was never a music video director. Everything had to have a story. So I did one on Patti LaBelle, Yo Mister. I did with Mavis Staple, but they're always stories.
Mm-hmm.
They were about the people, the characters, or whatever. Even the ones I did with Prince were stories. I just don't do a bunch of images flashing. I was, you know, even commercials, all my commercials had to have a beginning, middle, and an end. I couldn't just make a bunch of, you know, I did McDonald's and stuff like this. These people have to come into the restaurant, get their burger, and then leave. That's a story. That's a story. So, you know.
Well, tell me about this Freedom School project that you're doing. I can already see a gazillion connections between storytelling but I want to, you know, like, what's your perspective on the...
Well, I think, you know, what we tried to do, what my work was with working with them is that, again, I came in and, like, they just wanted to do a music video.
Okay, well, wait, I apologize. Let's back up and, like, mm-hmm. I got to explain the Freedom School a little bit, I know it's a youth program that was done primarily for African Americans in North Minneapolis, mm-hmm. and it was part of there was a bunch of Freedom Schools, is that correct?
Yeah, it's a national, through the Children's Defense Fund, and so it's in several cities or towns, whatever, and part of it was they wanted to do something with media, I encourage them that young teenagers need to understand a sense of responsibility of media and what it says.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, what it came out as I actually started a year before that is that I had was looking for something. I saw a fight on the street with some young teenagers fighting, and my first reaction was to pick up my phone and call the cops. The other young people around there, their first reaction was to videotape it with their cell phones.
Mm-hmm.
And I realized that they don't understand the medium, because now that goes out viral, that's never going to be come back to them. They turned it into another level of media exploitation. And I wanted to do it, and I ran into Ed, Michael Chaney and Ed Irwin, and they talked to me about this Freedom School, and that's how that experience started for me. And I wanted to really tell these kids to tell a story that was important to them. And so we came up with something called Our Community, Our Home, and I had them construct the story about their community and their home and what, from a positive standpoint, no police cars, no drug sales, mm-hmm. no gangs, a positive look at North Minneapolis. And that was the criteria. No hating. That was what I said. We're going to tell a real story, but we're going to tell it so that people will understand why people would live in North Minneapolis if it's this, you know, what some people consider or the newspaper consider this is a real negative environment. And so that's what we set out to do. And so we spent a summer doing that.
And so the kids that you were working with, so this is a different role for you. You're coming in mm-hmm. as like a youth worker in some mm-hmm. ways.
Yeah, yeah, it was totally.
So the kids that you're working with, did they have film experience beforehand, or was it like just
no.
like this
we
is their first?
We trained them on the whole. That, you know, we took kids who we thought were, for the most part, interested in filmmaking, interested in some kind of maybe citizen journalism approach, and trained them on cameras, editing, writing, had them read and write, and sometimes you needed a chair and a whip, but, you know.
No, this is not a literal whip.
No, just TV. No. No, he needed a real whip and a real chair sometimes. We didn't get one, but no, it was really trying to get them to understand that they have a sense of responsibility. The media is a weapon. I mean, you being a documentary filmmaker, there was in the Latin American community cinema, Novoa, who has talked about the cinema's gun, that whole theory that a gun can protect you, it can feed you, it can defend you, but it also can harm you. And filmmaking, cinema is the same thing. It can destroy cultures, it can destroy, you know, minds, it can destroy valuable things. And so you need to be responsible. You can't just shoot a street fight and think that that's okay.
So let's take a look at a clip from this, the Freedom School work,
right,
that is the opposite of what you're just describing there.
I think about community, I think about my surrounding areas. The family things on into the wider community.
Friends, neighbor, kids, friendship.
Businesses, stores, houses, community places for people to go and just conform a community.
To me, community means people who are connected to this particular geographic location in a deep and broad way.
If you make it, reach back and help someone else.
Your community is a whole lot more progressive than it used to be.
Community and family should be one, to tell you the honest truth, because the family should make sure that they are involved in the community activities.
Hey, hey, hey.
The Ojibwe people were the first people in Minnesota in the 17th century. There were also fur traders. George Bungle was born in 1802. George and his brother Stephen were famous for being the first two black children in Minnesota. George Bungle was also famous for being a black fur trader. In 1857, eight families of free African Americans and late settlers formed St. James AME Church in 1863. In that same year, a steamboat arrived in St. Paul, which carried 76 African Americans. The leader was Robert Hickman. He later became one of the most important figures of an African-American community.
That's the north side.
Most African-Americans came to Minnesota. They settled on the bend of Mississippi River at St. Anthony's, where other immigrants were. The African-American community wasn't until the 1920s. They were between Plymouth and Glenwood in the area around 6th Avenue, which is now called Ocean Highway. The blacks' population had increased to 8,809 by 1950 to 1970. The period was known as the Great Migration. The blacks' population in Minneapolis grew 436% of the state's population.
So how cool is that? I mean, you get a chance to, you know, get kids that may not have been the same kids that were on the corner filming with their cell phones, but you get to be really current by giving them these current technology tools,
right. But
you're forcing them to talk about history.
Yeah, and the positive aspects of life, and to really examine their community. And, you know, I love those kids, and, you know, a lot of them, and we know some of the same ones, and I love them. I see them on the streets, and we talk, and we joke, and it's this is their life, too, you know. And sometimes I think that we who don't live over there kind of look in the news media, it's like they're not really part of the real world. They're part of some other world, and this is their life. This is their community. This is where they live, and they needed to really see that. Because there is a lot of negative things over there, obviously, but there's a lot of positive, and that's what's the whole idea of the film. And this was really the first time I'd ever done this.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to say like I'm this other, you know, I learned from this as much as that working with them as I think they learned from me, is that really want to get beyond sort of what I learned in Hollywood, which is just to make as much money as you possibly can, get as many seats filled as you possibly can with whatever medium you can do that.
Mm-hmm.
It changed me.
So what other projects are you? I mean, are you working on a project that's about the Black Panthers coming up? Is that what I hear?
Yeah, well, thank you for bringing that up. No, it was. I've been working for probably almost 5-6 years on a series on the Black Panther Party. It was originally with HBO. It was an 8 1-hour episodes on the Black Panthers, a dramatic series. Just last in March, it went into turnaround, which means they put it on hold, and I have to start looking for another network to place it with. But I've been involved in that for a long time. We got 8 scripts, and it was Carl Franklin, who did Laurel Avenue here, but also was in Too Deep and The Pacific, and it was the writer and director on the project. And so right now, trying to get it back up and running again. But it's an incredible story, and I think that a lot of people misunderstand it, having me now, me sort of being in it and around the people who started this. It was 20-year-old kids who decided to really kind of help to create America the way they had envisioned it, or mm-hmm. the Founding Fathers really originally envisioned it. And it's just an amazing story. It wasn't just leather jackets and shotguns. It was really a political process, and a process that this country uses to this day. I mean, freedom, school lunches, and after-school programs, and free clinics, and voter registration. All that stuff came out of the Panther Party doctrine.
So if folks want to check out any of your work, whether it's, you know, the Gordon Parks documentary, or, I mean, like, there's a long list of film work you've been doing, or they want to, you know, see where this, the Black Panthers ends up going, how can people keep up with you?
I can't even keep up with myself. But I don't have a website, so I know this is like, I should have a website. Yes, I know. But, you know, Minnesota Film and TV Board always knows how to get in touch with the IFP. I've always been on their board and been involved with them for a number of years. I'm not hiding. I'm out there and, you know.
You're just doing.
Aaron
you're doing
got me.
Yeah.
So, you know, if Aaron can get me, you know, I'm around. So, you know, and one day soon I'm going to, I actually got my domain name set up. So I did get that far this year. So
nice.
I have to get a site up.
Nice, because it's just really great work, and I'll be curious to see, you know, as you keep going, mm-hmm. what develops. So I hope folks get a chance to check out Craig Laurence Rice, phenomenal local resource filmmaker, producer, director, award-winning. Thank you for joining us for this episode of Butter City. Check us out at www.buttercity.com. Check us out on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter. And we're here for a whole nother season, so stay tuned.